Good morning to you all. It's good to see you all this morning. Good to have you with us. Good to have some still tuning in over the internet. And whether they're there or here, I guess maybe in a sense it makes no difference. God hears all of us at once. In prophesying about the life of Christ, those men through inspiration talked about the physical sufferings he would endure. For example, the verses read at the beginning of the lesson, Isaiah 53:5. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. But in telling about Jesus and prophesying about the life he would have here, the prophets did not just talk about the physical suffering. They talked about his life of sorrow. They talked about his rejection. Isaiah 53:3, two verses before the first one I just read, he is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Jesus was certainly familiar with the physical sufferings that he had to endure, but there was emotional suffering. And I'm thinking part of that emotional suffering were the times that men disappointed him. If you read the life of Jesus, you can't help but notice he lived a life that had many disappointing days. There were many around him who disappointed him. Now, we think in the past couple of years we've had a lot of difficult days. We've had some disappointing days. We've had times when people disappointed us. But have we really had as many disappointing days as Jesus did? Do we think about the disappointments that he endured? Do you remember, do you think about some of the times that men disappointed him? And the question I'm going to ask you this morning to ponder is, what do you think was his most disappointing day? Some might say, well, surely it was the time that he healed those 10 lepers, that terrible, terrible disease, but only one came back to say thank you. Does he sound a little disappointed when he said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Luke 17:17. Or maybe more people would think about the night in the Garden of Eden. He was praying in dread of the crucifixion he was about to endure the next day. Matthew 26. Although he said to those who were around him, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. And he pled with those who were with him, stay here and watch with me. Every time he came back to them, they were asleep. Can you imagine the disappointment in his voice when he finally said, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Or perhaps it was when one of the inner circle, Peter, after Peter alleges that he is going to be faithful to Jesus no matter what happens, only a little while later he swore that he did not even know Jesus. How much disappointment was there in that look that Jesus gave to Peter? Luke 22:61-22. And when the Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the words of the Lord, Peter went out and wept bitterly. Disappointing days. Disappointing days indeed. But would one of these have been the most disappointing day? I want to ask you to consider one additional possibility for Jesus' most disappointing day. How about the day he was resurrected as his most disappointing day? Early Sunday morning when he came forth from the tomb. I'm guessing that was not one of the days that you were thinking about. And you may be saying, Stan, why would you even mention that one? That was a great day. It was a victorious day. Victorious over the grave, victorious over sin, victorious over death. It was a great day, his resurrection day. In fact, it was such a great day that that's the day that in the event that we commemorate each week. And we talk about his resurrection. We're talking about his resurrection day this morning. But this morning I'm asking you the unusual question. Could that have been his most disappointing day? And you say, well, Stan, why could it have been disappointing? Well, because when he came forth from that grave, there was nobody there to greet him. Not only were there not hundreds of people there shouting, we knew that God would not leave his anointed one in the grave. Not only were there not hundreds of people there ready to hoist him up on their shoulders, carry him through the streets of Jerusalem, there was not even a small welcoming party. In fact, there was no one there. No one. Well, why might we think that there should have been people there? Well, they should have been there because Jesus told all of his followers all that they needed to know to be ready and waiting for him from when he arose from the dead on that specific day. I'll remind you of some of the times he told him. You may be surprised. You may be surprised to hear how many times and with what detail and how explicitly he told them he was coming forth from the grave on the third day. You may remember the confession of Peter in Matthew 16:16, "You are the Christ, you are the Son of the living God." Just a few verses down, the rest of the story. "And from that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and be raised the third day." And this was not a one-time revelation that he gave them. It says, from that time, he began to show them these things. He told them over and over and over again, not only of his death, but specifically, explicitly, of his resurrection on the third day. Let me just give you a few more examples. I picked these all from the book of Matthew. Matthew 17:22-23. "Now while they were staying in Galilee, Jesus said to them, 'The Son of Man is about to be betrayed into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and the third day he will be raised up.'" He said he would be killed, but he said he would be raised up the third day. And there are other instances as time went along. In Matthew chapter 20, Jesus, on his way to Jerusalem, just a few days before his crucifixion, he took the disciples aside and told them once again in detail. Matthew 20:18, "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed into the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and scourge and to crucify, and the third day he will rise again." It would have been hard for him to make it any clearer to them what was going to happen. They should have known that the third day after the crucifixion was going to be a great day, a victorious day, his victorious day over the grave. But you know, in defense of the apostles, we like to defend those who are not here to defend themselves. We might observe that Jesus said many things that were not easy to understand. He spoke in parables, and other times he used language that seemed to confuse those who were around him. But in this case, there were others who seemed to clearly understand what he was saying. His enemies understood. They knew Jesus said the third day was a significant day. Matthew 27:62, "On the next day after his burial, the chief priests and Pharisees gathered together to Pilate." This is the Jewish leaders gathering in front of the Roman leader in that area. And what did those Jewish leaders say to Pilate, the Roman ruler? "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how this deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will arise.'" They understood what Jesus had said about that third day, and they were taking precautions. What they asked Pilate was, "Therefore command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, 'He is risen from the dead.'" They wanted guards around the tomb. Now, Pilate refused to give Roman guards. The Jewish leaders provided their own guards around the tomb because they may not have believed that Jesus was the Christ, but they clearly understood what he had said and said and said about that third day. It was going to be significant because he was going to come forth from the dead. He had not hidden that fact even from his enemies, and he had certainly not hidden it from his friends, his apostles. The enemies were there at the tomb. The guards were there. Where were his friends? They weren't there. Now, somebody might object, "Man, but Stan, there were two of his friends that were there. The two Marys were there." And that's true. Matthew 28:1, "As the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to the tomb." Well, they were there. But Mark tells us the rest of the story. Mark 16:1, "Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices that they might come to anoint him. His friends were there, but they did not come to welcome the resurrected Christ from the tomb. They came there that morning to anoint his dead body. So how disappointing could that have been? He had been with them day and night, and he told them time after again. And he had fulfilled many prophecies in front of them. He had performed many miracles. And yet, when he fulfilled the greatest prophecy of all, spoken by his own lips, about coming forth from the grave on the third day, who was there? Who was looking in anticipation of his resurrection, of his return? No one. No one was there. So you see now maybe why I could put this on the list of candidates for his most disappointing day. Maybe that would have been his most disappointing day, unless, what if nobody is looking for him when he returns to the earth? I mean, he told them he was coming forth from the grave. They didn't listen. They weren't there. He has told us he's coming back. Just as surely as he said he was coming forth from the grave, and his messengers relayed that message in the scriptures, Jesus said he's coming again. Jesus said, John 14:2-3, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. This is a promise he made. He says, I will return. It's a promise we can count on. But really, Jesus is not the only one that gives us assurances about his return. When the apostles stood there on that mountain watching him ascend up into the heavens, the angels told those apostles, Acts 1:11, men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. Apostle Paul gives us a detailed description. This is a wonderful passage. 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God. The dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. A careful reading of that passage would clear up a lot of the misunderstandings that people have about the return of Jesus. These verses do not, neither is there any other verse in the Bible that says when he returns, he will set one foot on this earth. What the verses say is that those who are his followers, their feet will leave the earth in order to go meet him in the air. A wonderful event, an amazing event. He is coming back. And we have been told that again and again. Somebody counted what they decided were the scriptures that talked about his second coming, his return. They would suggest that over 300 references in the New Testament to the second coming. He's told us he's coming back. His apostles, his faithful messengers have told us he's coming back. And we've been told to watch. In some of his final lessons on this earth, Jesus said, watch, Matthew 24:42. Watch, therefore, Jesus says, for you do not know the hour your Lord is coming. That's Matthew 24. Matthew 25, watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour at which the Son of Man is coming. And we need to conclude from all this that all of this is not just watching to make sure we see the event. We're supposed to be watching in great anticipation. It's going to be a great occasion. I said before that we are blessed to live between the greatest events in church history. We are blessed to live between the two greatest events in human history, in the history of this planet, the first coming of Jesus and the second coming of Jesus. Our watching for him is not just our watchfulness to be prepared lest we be lost, although that's part of it. It should be a watchfulness that is in great anticipation. His return will be a great occasion, another day of victory. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes that when he returns, not only will the dead be raised, but his faithful ones will be chained. They will have immortality. 1 Corinthians 15:54, death is swallowed up in victory. It will be a great day of victory for Christ and for us. Should be a day that we're looking forward to, not just looking forward in anticipation of, but forward to in the sense of gladness for the day when it comes. The Hebrews writer says, Hebrews 9:28, to those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time apart from sin unto salvation. Romans 8:25, to the Christians at Rome, Paul wrote, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. To the church at Corinth, Paul writes of eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians 1:7. To the Philippians, Paul writes, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, Philippians 3:20. We're supposed to be eagerly waiting. One of the greatest events in human history. And those who are his faithful followers, it is going to be such a wonderful day. And yet I wonder sometimes whether we even think about it. Are there days that go by? Are there weeks that go by? Some of you I know think about it because I listen to your prayers and I hear in your prayers the mention of it. I just don't know how often the rest of us even think about it. It's supposed to be a great day, like the day of his resurrection. It's supposed to be an anticipated day, an anticipated day with great eagerness. We cannot know the day, so we're supposed to be eagerly waiting and looking all the time. I wonder if there's a chance that we could be disappointing our Lord in the same way that those who were not there at his tomb when he came forth from the grave. What if he comes forth from heaven this afternoon or tonight? Will anybody be thinking about it? Will anybody be watching? Will anybody be eager for it to happen? Will there be at least one person who is looking, eagerly waiting for that event? Will there be one person? Will it be me? Will it be you? You know, he told his followers then that he was coming forth from the grave. We have a measure of their faith by their attitude toward the fulfillment of that promise. He's told his followers now that he's coming forth from heaven. We have a measure of our faith by our attitude toward the fulfillment of that great promise. We need to be watching. Appreciate Cliff singing the song. We have a song that will remind us. Are we watching? Are we eagerly anticipating it? Part of being ready so we can eagerly watch is obeying the plan of salvation. The plan of salvation that was made possible by his resurrection from the dead and becoming obedient to the one who was resurrected. He announced that plan as he left the earth. He said, Mark 16:16, he who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not believe will be condemned. So what do people need to do? Well, they need to start by believing. They need to start by believing in God. Believing in God and Jesus as the creators of all things that we know. They need to start by believing in God as he gave his message through Jesus as the ultimate source, the only source of spiritual authority for our lives. We need to believe that. We need to be willing to confess the relationship between the Father and the Son, that Jesus is the Son of the Heavenly Father. He is the Christ. He is that promised Messiah, that promised anointed one. Matthew 10:32, Jesus expects us to confess him. Romans 10:9-10, Paul says that confession is linked with our salvation. Once we understand that, and if we believe in God and believe in the great things he's done for us and our responsibility to him, then our hearts should naturally turn in repentance and changing of the mind and heart from the things that we've done in the past that we know were not in accordance with God's will. Repent, change our wills to conform our will to his will, 2 Corinthians 7:10. And then they need to do the rest of the thing that Jesus talked about in that verse in Mark 16:16. To be baptized. How many references are there in the New Testament to baptism? Acts 2:38 says it's for the remission of sins. 1 Peter 3:21 says it's to be saved. Those who have not done those things, they're not ready. They are not ready for that return of Christ. But for those of us who have done those things, When we think about the return of Christ, are we eager for that return? Do we have a reluctance? I think it's kind of a logical statement that if we are not eager for his return, we must know that there is something in our life that is not right. We need to examine our lives. We need to examine our hearts. We need to purge out those things that we know are keeping us from following God, the things that are keeping us from being obedient to Christ. Those things that would keep us from being eager for his return. We need to think about those things. We need to repent of those things. We need to purge those things from our life. If we will do that, we'll have a happier life every day of our life. Our scriptures admonish us to watch and be ready and be eager. And maybe the level of our eagerness is a telltale sign of how prepared we think we are for that day. Prepare for the day. If there's some way that we can help you, please come forward this morning or talk to us after this assembly.
There's a great day coming, a great day coming, there's a great day coming by and by, when the saints and the sinners shall be parted right in mass. Are you ready for that day to come? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? Are you ready? Are you ready for the judgment day? There's a bright day coming, a bright day coming, there's a bright day coming by and by, but its brightness shall only come to them that love the Lord. Are you ready for that day to
number 337. Low in the grave he lay. We're going to sing this song before our communion this morning.
Low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior. He arose, hallelujah.
Each first day of the week, we partake in the Lord's Supper as commanded. Looking at the bulletin, unless it's changed, it looks like tonight's lesson will follow nicely with this morning's. Why do we observe the Lord's Supper every Sunday and only on Sunday? In Romans 6, continuing with Christ's resurrection, we read that as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we've been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is free from sin. Pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank thee, Lord, for this day that thou hast given us. Father, we are thankful for the opportunities that we have to gather, to worship thee. So very grateful for thy Son and for the willing sacrifice that he made, that our sins can be washed away and we can walk in the newness of life. Father, we pray that as we partake of this bread, which represents thy Son's body, we'd each examine ourselves, looking back to the cross, remembering thy Son's death. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Heavenly Father, as we humbly approach thee again in prayer, we thank thee, Lord, for thy love and for thy mercy. Father, we pray that as we partake of this cup, the fruit of the vine, which represents thy Son's shed blood, that we would remember, because of his shed blood, that our sins can be washed away. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Put the empty cup in the pew in front of you. Thank you.
It has been so good to be here to worship God. I have some announcements before we close today, before we sing our closing song and have our closing prayer. Number of announcements. First, let's continue to pray for those on our prayer list. There are a lot of people. If you look in the bulletin, you'll see them. Please, let's continue to pray for them. We give thanks to God for the great news about Scott Springer. His surgery went well. He is recovering, and the doctors have given him two thumbs up. I mean, things sound like they're doing real well. But it will be about 6 weeks before he's really back to his normal routine. He should be released from the hospital later this week. I say should be because who knows, the doctor may say, no, we need to keep him for one more day. No. Should be released from the hospital later this week, but for now, they're not letting him have visitors because of the swelling and the pain meds and so forth, that it's really, really wreaking havoc on him. But he is recovering, and that's the great thing. We can send cards, text messages, Facebook messages, all of these things he appreciates so greatly, and let's continue to encourage him. Kathy and James and Jacob continue to pray for them as well. James came home from camp and he had a fever and a headache, and he's recovering from that. Don't know if it's COVID or anything like that, but fever and a headache, could have been a lot of sugar, a lot of sun, who knows, but let's pray for him. A fever and a headache is never a good thing, especially nowadays. Great news again, with Tyler and Anita Lee. Avery June Lee was born on Tuesday, June 21st,
And then so big brother Caden now has a little sister to torment. Dude, she's her early arrival. She is in the NICU to allow her lungs to get stronger. So she was not a preemie, but she definitely came earlier than anticipated. Anita's home and doing well. And let's pray for them on behalf of Avery. There will be a baby shower on Saturday, the 9th of July, for Anita and Avery, from 11 to 1:30 in the annex. So check your V-files, your folders for more information. The 4th of July, this upcoming Monday, not tomorrow, but the following Monday, there will be a picnic here at the building after the 4th of July parade. Right across in front of us. So there is a sign-up sheet on the youth bulletin board. If you go out the foyer, turn left through the double doors, the sign-up sheets are almost right in front of you there. Check it out. See what openings there are to bring food, goodies, and things like that. Please sign up for that. If you plan to be here, how many people are coming? Also, on the Saturday, the 16th of July, is our one-day VBS. We're really looking forward to this. And again, please check the bulletin board. This is the one in the foyer. There's some sign-up sheets there for opportunities to help, for teaching, for bringing food and bringing things and so forth. So please check out the bulletin board. There are several sign-up sheets there, so check them all. Make sure you look at those. And let's see. Also, we're talking about praying for others on our prayer list, the community of Uvalde, Texas. Let's continue to pray for them. The book drive is something that we can thank Sister Kim Coben for being the pointy end of the spear on that one. There's a box that's out over by the table right outside or right next to the bulletin board for new or gently used books. And please bring them in and place them in the box, and she will gather them and take them to a collection point in the city or in this area here for the young people in Uvalde. Some books that they can read with family members and help them with the healing process. Deadline for this is the 1st of July. That's this upcoming Friday. So by Wednesday, if you can bring them here, that's fine during the week. But by Wednesday, certainly, if you have any books, please bring them, put them in the box, and we'll be grateful for them. Those are all the announcements I have. Let's stand and sing our closing song and have our closing prayer after that.
Number 734 is our song, closing song. And for those of you online, it's called Wonderful is My Redeemer. Wonderful is my Redeemer, wonderful is He, saving me from sin and sorrow, what to Calvary. Wonderful the Prince of Glory, mighty God is He. Wonderful is my Redeemer, wonderful to me. Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Gave Himself for my fears there at Calvary. Marvelous, saving grace, set my spirit free. Wonderful is my Redeemer, wonderful is He. He gave Himself to die a ransom yonder tree. His saving grace my soul to save, could it ever be? Salvation's plan for every man, He purchased pardon free. Wonderful is my Redeemer, wonderful to me.
Wonderful,
wonderful, Jesus is to me. Gave Himself for my care, there at Calvary. Marvelous saving grace sets my spirit free. Wonderful is my Redeemer, wonderful is He. Redeeming love sent from above, He died for you and me. Go tell the message
message of his love. Salvation now is free. No longer waste the fields or wide the call or distant sea. Wonderful is my Redeemer, wonderful to me. Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Gave himself for my share there at Calvary. Marvelous saving grace set my spirit free. Wonderful is my Redeemer, wonderful is he.
Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we humbly come to you in prayer at this time, giving thanks for this opportunity to come and study your word and sing your praises. We come in prayer for Scott as he recovers from his surgery. We pray that it'll be a quick recovery. We come in prayer for Sharon Anderson, who's also had surgery. And the entire Springer family has had such tribulations this last past week. Come in prayer for baby Avery, that she soon will be able to go home and be with the family. As we go our several ways, yes, you guide and direct us, protect us, and bring us back to the next point in time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.